Silvia Federici is Professor Emerita of International Studies and Political Philosophy at Hofstra University. Raised in Italy, she moved to the United States in 1967 to undertake her doctoral studies in philosophy at the University of Buffalo. Little did I know until yesterday, she also has a background in literary studies. She wrote her first dissertation in Italy on Herman Melville, a fitting intersection with Eric Schockett's scholarship. She was involved with the Italian New Left and the movements for workers' autonomy in the 1970s, as well as the student and anti-war movements and the national welfare rights movement of that era, and was a founding figure in the Wages for Housework movement and the International Feminist Collective. In the 1980s, she taught in Nigeria and has subsequently spent time in Mexico and Latin America, experiences which shaped her political awareness of women's global and local struggles for autonomous collective forms of self-reproduction and government. Her interests and insights are wide-ranging on topics such as food sovereignty, which she defines as a call for autonomy and self-determination, a rejection of the capitalist model of agriculture that expropriates people from their lands and their traditional knowledge, social justice, the effects of globalization, and the legacies of colonialism. In addition to her activism, Professor Federici is, of course, well known for her scholarship in the Marxist feminist tradition, including her immensely influential and landmark analysis of the history of witch hunts in Europe in the 16th and 17th centuries, Caliban and the Witch. This fundamentally radical book, and I mean that in the best possible way, the copyright page of which lists an anti-copyright date of 2004, and which, an interviewer notes, has circulated freely in Xerox copies, this is a quote, Xerox copies stacked in info shops, PDFs shared online, earmarked copies read out loud during road trips, and passed among friends like a secret shared text. The book has been described as obligatory reading for anyone interested in eco-socialism and eco-feminism, and offers a riveting analysis of the historical reproduction of the sexual division of labor under capitalism, what she refers to as the patriarchy of the wage. Among her many other publications are an earlier book, co-authored with Leopoldina Fortunati, Il Grande Calibano, translated as The Great Caliban, History of the Rebel Body in the First State of Capitalism. The edited collection, Enduring Western Civilization, The Construction of the Concept of Western Civilization and Its Others. And Revolution at Point Zero, Housework, Reproduction, and Feminist Struggle from 2012. Her most recent publication with Arlen Austin is Wages for Housework, The New York Committee, 1972 to 1977, History, Theory, Documents. And this is a text that we do have in the Hampshire collection, so I urge you to check it out. It's a rich archival resource for anyone interested in the still revolutionary conception that the forms of domestic labor traditionally assigned to women should be remunerated and denaturalized or degenderized in Federici's term. Please join me in welcoming the transformative thinker, scholar, and activist, Professor Silvia Federici.
Thank you very much, and good evening to all of you, and thank you for coming here. I want to begin, you know, by thanking those who have invited me, and first of all, Lisa Sanders and Jennifer Biorek. And of course, I feel very, very privileged that I'm given this opportunity to speak and make a presentation in honor of the work of Eric Schockett. I've only recently become familiar with his work, and I have to confess I've not been able yet to read all of Vanishing Moments, but I've been already impressed by the parts that I've read. And as Liz Sander pointed out, you know, he has given a great contribution to our understanding of the politics of class, because he has, confronted, he has developed two conceptions of class, and argue that all through its literary representation, as well as I imagine its political representation, class has been in the United States, very much fetishized, naturalized, in the sense it has identified with a particular set of work with a particular set of jobs, with a particular set of workers, rather than being identified with the recognition of an antagonistic relation to an exploitative system that may take different forms and may be expressed through different forms of employment, through different forms of exploitation, but in a sense a structural, systemic, and not, you know, reducible to any particular set of activity or forms of employment. I think this is a very, very powerful critique of some of the dominant representation of class. And in support of this view, and in honor of Eric Schockett's work, you know, I've decided to use his distinction between these two different conceptions of class to use them in a way to rethink the limits and political potential at the same time of the feminist movement of the 70s, and also to think about a feminist program of struggle for the present, for today, that is capable or should be capable of, you know, going beyond, you know, the struggle for improvement of the condition of women, as crucial as that is, using the concept of women in the broadest sense, but should be capable of, in fact, you know, opening the way to a reconstruction of social relation, you know, beyond, away from a society based on the devaluation of human life and the continuous destruction of people's hopes for the future. So this is going to be the foundation for my talk, and which will be rather schematic, because I'm very interested in working with some key ideas and then hearing from you, because the idea of speaking about the feminist movement, you know, it's really generated by the realization that there is a new feminism that is growing, and it's growing not only in the United States, but it's growing at the international level. And I'm very concerned as an older, as a senior feminist, as an older woman, I'm very concerned to share and reflect upon and share with you, you know, my sense of what we tried to accomplish in the past and the limits and the possibility, you know, of those efforts. So to begin with, I will say that the feminist movement, you know, implicitly, if not explicitly in the sense of its recognition of it, but implicitly gave an enormous contribution to a redefinition of the concept of class, very much away from what was at the time its dominant conception, which was class is the industrial worker, the blue-collar worker, with the you know, helmet, and basically based in the factory. The women's movement in its revolt, you know, in its revolt, because it was a movement of revolt against the male dominance, against confinement to domesticity, to domestic work, against the duty to be a beautiful object, against the imposed maternity, maternity imposed as a condition for women to be accepted socially, right? In a way, opened up, and I think that this was one of his major contributions, opened up a whole field of exploitation that had been hidden, made invisible, you know, by the fact that it had taken place in an area that was defined as a private area, and by the fact that the work involved in those, in that sphere of life, you know, was largely unpaid. And, you know, we live in a society where the association between wages and work has become almost, you know, a natural fact. And so the women's movement, in a way, tore the veil, you know, in of away from the private sphere, and basically revealed that, you know, the sphere of familial relations, sexuality, domesticity, you know, it's very much traversed by power relation. And above all, it's a sphere of work and production. And in fact, a crucial sphere of production, because what we discover has been produced in the home, it was really the workforce itself. In other words, the contribution that the women's movement gave, right, to the redefinition of class was to see the women not just as wife, daughter, sisters of factory workers, were part of the working class, but in their own name, they were in fact involved in a class relation with capital and with the state. They were involved in a process of production to the extent that they were the producers of the workers themselves. They're seen in their totality, all the activities that have gone under the name of housework. In fact, seen in their totality, they amounted to a process of production, you know, the production of the worker, its, her, his capacity to work, to reappear every day in the work wage workplace. So this, for many of us, was in fact what I often call the Copernican Revolution. You know, turned the world upside down. The Copernican Revolution, in that, you know, we realized that actually, far from being irrelevant, far from being marginal or a leftover of a pre-capitalist society, we discovered that in fact, this domestic work, it's in a way central to capitalist accumulation, is in fact the pillar, because if you don't produce workers, you also do not produce any other commodity. And so that all of a sudden we saw that the work of the, you know, women, the work that women will do in the home, whether they had a work outside the home or not, right, was really fundamental to the process. I could speak a long time on the kind of change that this produced in our, and the kind of research, the kind of rethinking of gender relation, the kind of rethinking, above all, of what is capitalism. But I will only want to make a few comments, which is that discovering this work and discovering and wondering why, if it is so central, it has been so invisibilized and so marginalized, and concluding that it was precisely because of its centrality, because if this work had been recognized and had to be waged, had to be remunerated in some form, clearly capitalism would have gone bankrupt. Which is that to say that in fact the capitalist class has been able to build an enormous amount of accumulation on the unpaid labor of women, and you know, justified, of course, you know, on by the naturalization of this work. And important for us was also to see the relationship, the profound structural relationship between sexism and racism, to see, in fact, beginning, you know, from the realization that capitalist, the capitalist system that feeds upon an amount of unpaid labor far wider than what was ever told to us by the founding fathers of the socialist movement, immediately revealed the connection between the condition of women and what had been the condition of slavery, not to say, not to minimize in any way what the brutality and the horror of the slave system, but to see that was also part, you know, of a structural devaluation of entire population of human beings upon which capitalism has built, you know, its wealth. In other words, that a connecting link has been this need, which is a structural systemic need of the capitalist system, you know, to create population of people who are completely rightless, who have super exploited, whose exploitation is justified as a natural deficiency, as coming because of a natural deficiency. And we saw that continuity, came to realization that sexism and racism are really structural systemic elements of the system, which immediately posed for a number of us the need to think of a feminism and of a feminist struggle beyond the society, you know, devoted not simply to the improvement of the condition of women, as fundamental as I said that is, but also posing the question of the change, the structural change of social relation, you know, that this began to be what we call an anti-capitalist, you know, feminist movement. Quite briefly, I will not want to dwell on the strategy of wages for housework, but for the time, for a number of us, wages for housework seemed a strategy that promised to, in fact, undermine that use of women's work, and that the subordination of the whole sphere of affective, emotional, procreative relation, you know, to the needs of the labor market. You know, so we believe that wages for housework would be a way to confront and, you know, starting from a problem that in different ways, you know, whole women share, or most women share, at least women in the working class community share, that this would be a path to challenge what we saw as the devaluation of women's work and the devaluation of our lives. And I think this was the time, this was the context where for me the question of the goals, the objective of the feminist movement began to change, you know, to concentrate, and this will be a theme throughout my talk, to concentrate on the idea that, you know, because women have an historic experience of reproductive work, in a way, they are the subject that it's most effective to operate, to struggle against that devaluation, which is not only devaluation of women's work, it's really devaluation of people's life. In a way, I think the women's movement, and here now I speak personally, for me showed that starting from an experience that many women have had historically, we could actually see something about capitalism. We could actually see something that, in a way, you know, forced us to think of a society beyond capitalism. So this was not the path that was taken by the dominant trend in the feminist movement. And it's very clear that by the mid-1970s, for instance, the more class-conscious section of the feminist movement were already moving in a different direction, identifying, in a sense, with class power in a way different than the one I have described. In other words, I believe that the feminist movement by the mid-70s began to embrace a concept of class, and that was far closer to the traditional concept that, for example, Eric Schockett criticized. By 1974, from my personal experience, for example, in New York State, much of the energy of the feminist movement was directed towards the creation of a labor women's union and breaking into male-dominated area of work, you know, became one of the designated means of emancipation, and increasingly the struggle for parity, equality in the workplace and equality in society, equal pay or comparable pay for equal work, or equal pay for comparable work. I am not undermining or reducing the importance of this struggle. I only want to emphasize that, in my view, these objectives were excessively limited and, in a way, precluded that broader transformative process that I think potentially the feminist movement was capable of. And because the organization and because organization of political activity in the workplace, entering the wage workplace, organizing, you know, with the labor movement became such dominant goal, you know, strategically dominant goal. The effects of it were the abandonment of reproduction as a terrain of struggle. And the most evident sign of it was that by 1976, when the issue of maternity leave went to the Supreme Court, the women's movement did not mobilize, as there was very much a fear that if you organized on any issue strongly around reproduction, particularly on issues of maternity, you would jeopardize your possibility of being treated equally, of being given equal consideration once you were outside of the home. So that you, with few exceptions, for example, the struggle against domestic violence and also the struggle and denunciation of the institutional tolerance of rape, largely, you see that in the period between 74, 75, and the turn of the decade, you see a gradual abandonment of the question of reproduction. One exception being the struggle against the efforts that began at a very early stage to limit the right of abortion. But, for instance, the feminist movement, and this I described in one of my writing as a tragic mistake, did not come out and mobilize the mass in support of the struggle of welfare mothers, which was a struggle led predominantly by black women, not because black welfare was a predominantly black issue. On the contrary, most of the recipients were white women, right? But because black women were far more combative, far more organized, and came from a whole background of struggle, the civil rights movement, the Black Power movement. And so they were, in fact, you know, had an organizational ability and the will to struggle, you know, far, far stronger. And the feminist movement did not come out en masse in the same number that we saw in the streets, in the struggle for abortion, in support of Black women fighting for welfare, at the time when the same women were saying, every mother is a working mother, welfare is not a charity. When the state needs soldiers, they come and take our children. When they need worker for their factory, they come and take our children. And this is a feminist issue. And we saw it as a feminist issue because we saw welfare as, in a way, the first money the women had been able to win in recognition of the work of raising children. Again, you know, we did not have the same mobilization in the women's movement against the way predominantly Black but also immigrant women were threatened by the late 70s with the sterilization, particularly if they were on welfare whenever they went to a hospital to give birth. And unfortunately, abortion was seen and identified with control over our own body, whereas real control over our own body, it's really also creating the condition, the possibility for women to reproduce, you know, in ways that do not jeopardize their life. And we have seen, in fact, I think it's been a very important development to see that in response to the, you know, what is called the choice movement, a new movement has been generated mostly again by Black women for reproductive justice. Reproductive justice that recognizes precisely that other side of choice, that other side, and at the same time begins to rethink, has begun to rethink the condition under which women give birth. And recognizing that for many, many women, giving birth has been turned into a sort of nightmare, into an event that generates fear rather than an event that is met with celebration. Not only because of the increasing cost. It's calculated that, you know, giving birth to a child today can cost you $4,000 just to give birth, but also because, you know, encounter with the medical system have become more and more traumatic. More and more traumatic. Today, by the way, it's even more traumatic than in the 70s, because many times if you go to one of the clinics where you know, people with low income go to give birth, and you are likely being subjected to blood tests. And if those blood tests reveal any abnormality, which, given the state of technology, may not be a real thing, you know, the women in question will be jailed, will be arrested, will be accused of having jeopardized the fetus, because we have seen over the last few years, you know, every state now competing to give more rights to the fetus and more rights that they are, in fact, taking away from women. So we saw this move that by the late 70s, what had been a powerful movement that had presence in the street, that with all its limits had represented a social force, in fact, had become disarticulated, and in fact, unable to resist the kind of restructuring that were taking place. Very briefly, because I really want to leave a lot of time for discussion, I will only say that in a way, the decision by dominant trends in the feminist movement to make entrance into the wage workplace, right, the dominant strategy for emancipation, was an Himalayan miscalculation. An Himalayan miscalculation, not only, and I'm using a Gandhi's expression, not only because it involved abandoning the question of reproduction, the question of the really devaluation of reproductive life in all its aspects, but also because the women's entrance into the wage workplace coincided with a major, major restructuring of wage labor that, in fact, stripped it of all its benefits, stripped it of all the guarantees and benefits that it had provided in the past. You know, the late 70s are the time, when you have a global restructuring, a restructuring of the global economy, right? The dismantles industrial sites all through the United States, they seize the state as cutting all investment in every form of reproduction, particularly in all those services that were more crucial to women's life, you know, childcare, care for the elderly. And in fact, those cuts have continued. And we have seen, therefore, what now we call a financialization of reproduction. Financialization meaning that more and more, you know, women have had to pay, people have had to pay for services that in the past were either provided for free or subsidized by the state. For example, you know, education. Women and men of my generation went to university practically for free. But healthcare, care for the elderly. So you find now, looking retrospectively, and here again, I'm forced to be very, very quick, but I need to speak to it, that although for a significant number of women, entrance into the wage workforce was in fact allowed them to gain more autonomy from men and more rewarding occupation. For the majority of women, in fact, the conditions of work and life have, if anything, deteriorated. Today, the majority of women in the United States are often working at 2-3 jobs, have no time to rest. In addition, the jobs they have are at the bottom of the organizational work and pay scale. So that, in fact, today, women in the U.S., the working woman, what is defined officially as the working woman, you know, I put it in quote because to me, those who also do unpaid labor are working women. But the working woman is the woman who is most carries the majority of debt in the country. In other words, women who have a job have, you know, debts that they might not pay for the rest of their life. They have the majority of the debt in education, of student loan, the majority of the debt in mortgages, and this is particularly true of women, Afro-descendant women, black women, the majority of debt, and also immigrant women, and the majority of debt in payday loans. You know, payday loans, the payday loan industry, it's an industry of vultures that has really been generated, you know, really to feed on women access to now have a wage. You know, so finally women be having a wage, they are given credit. So they are given credit, that means that you know, they can be exploited as data. And in fact, a very large number of women now owe huge amount, because the interest rates that are charged are up to 50%. And you ask yourself, why women are accepting that? Well, they're accepting that for two reasons. They're accepting that first because they need it, because they don't earn enough to get to the end of the month. And so they live, there's a whole population of women now who live from hand to mouth. And secondly, because they are not subjected, they can receive those loans by the internet, avoiding face-to-face interviews. And so they don't have to show that they have collateral, which they do not have. And therefore, they are vulnerable to these very predatory scales of. So there is a whole literature now that I think is really important to be familiar with, because it gives you an idea also. There is a violence that we see, institutional violence that we see almost every day in the streets, with the killing of black youth and the killing of youth, of the killing of children, that is basically institutionally protected by the fact that there is a refusal to introduce the kind of legislation that would prevent those deaths. But there is also an institutional violence that is organized through policy, through economic policy. It's organized through massive and continuous impoverishment, that is organized by forcing so many people to live with a sense of insecurity about the future. Women are among those, the largest population of those who today are robbed of their future. And they are robbed of their health. Official statistics are that women today live 5 years on average less than their mothers. Working class women, and when I talk about women, I'm talking about working class women or proletarian women, whether they're working or not working, they are working class women. In fact, the idea that if you're unemployed, you're not working is an illusion. I think it's very important to get rid of the idea, particularly those who are speaking of the end of work. In reality, people are working more than ever. And what has happened, what is the situation with reproduction? As we know, when we look at the conditions of reproduction for the majority of working class family, proletarian family, unemployed, low income, today, it's very much a disaster area. Because we see that the absence of women who have moved from the home to work outside the home has not been compensated by any structure, by any service. And here, you know, I suggest that it's really a need for people, particularly young people who want to change the world, to familiarize themselves, familiarize yourself with, what is taking place, you know, with regard to, for example, you know, the general health situation of working class people, the fact that people go, many, many women go to the hospital or to the doctor's office, you know, when they have a cancer, you know, spread into their body because they don't have security and medical security. There you have children who have now been drugged from the age of 4 or 5 with different kinds of pills, antidepressive, you know, dyslexia, deficit, attention deficit in schools, right? All the problems, the institutional problems, the institutionally created problems are being medicalized and addressed through basically the drugging, you know, in a country that is waging a war against drugs, waging a war against drugs across the world, which is actually a war against people who are holding on to their land. This is what the war against drugs really is. But, you know, actually, it's giving tremendous amount of drugs, medicalizing the problem that has to do with the lack of investment in children, lack of investment in old elder people, you know. And I think you'll be really, I always say that if you want to think of changing the world, it's also very important to understand, you know, and become familiar with aspects of this society that still remain completely invisible. Like, for example, what is happening in the hospitals, what has been happening in the nursing home, where the continuous cuts, year after year, cuts of budgets, cuts of personnel, increase of the number of hours, right, are you know, resulting in incredible misery, you know, in elder people often, you know, living days and days without being moved in their beds, in an isolation that it's hard to imagine how terrible it can be. So I would argue that we are facing a major reproduction crisis, major, major reproduction crisis at all levels. And that because of this reproduction crisis, and also because of the struggle that people are working in the public sector, for example, teachers, for example, you know, domestic workers. Well, this is not the public sector, but some of them are working also in the public sector. We now have a broader awareness, you know, in the feminist, what we call the feminist movement or among feminists, about the question of reproductive work. And for instance, there's been more interest since the 19th. There's been a growing interest in care work, mostly fostered, promoted, I believe, by the struggle of domestic workers. Because all along the restructuring of the global economy, there's also been a global restructuring of reproductive work. Right? As we know, this is now we understand that much of the work of the reproduction of the American proletariat is now done, you know, by women coming from, you know, impoverished countries, you know, of Africa, Latin America, Asia, right? And, you know, who have been subjected to, you know, great amount of abuse and taken a lot of risk, you know, determined, however, to find ways of providing for their family back home. And over the years have begun to organize. And this has been one of the struggles that has placed the issue of reproduction back, you know, to on the table, you know, for many feminists. So there is a much broader awareness today of the importance of reproduction, not only for our life, but also, you know, for the reproduction of the capitalist system. And you're probably aware there's now a whole literature coming out from universities like Hampshire and others, and UMass, Holyoke, everybody, on the issue of social reproduction, right? Now women speak of feminists, women or men or others, speak of social reproduction with the realization that a lot of reproductive work is now taking place out of the home. Right? Either because it's commercialized, right, like the classical fast food joint, or because it's done by immigrant women, it's done for pay. So there is a much more awareness of this work, right? But what I do not see, and I think what we are still far from seeing, is a program, a project, a vision of the kind of struggles that we need to do in order to transform and reproductive work, and also in order to respond to its systematic devaluation, right? So the kind of solution that are offered, and please, you will tell me if I'm being excessively critical. So, but the kind of solution that are offered is still very much, struggling for better services. Right? The idea being that the alternative to domestic work, to unpaid domestic labor, etc., is basically the state providing better forms of reproduction, better services, or another alternative, more sharing of reproduction work with men, right? But what I think is missing, and what I'm responding to, is the lack of a broader vision of a reconceptualization of reproduction in ways that begins to reclaim space, resources, reclaim our bodies, away from the control of the state. And this is, for me, I have been in the years more and more interested in a question that I would define the question of the commons as not necessarily, in contradiction with or completely in alternative, to the struggle for more services and also the struggle for more monetary sources to be placed at the service of reproductive work, right? But certainly, as a path, to reclaim control over the most fundamental aspects of our life. And at the same time, to begin to reunite activities that capitalism has divided. And in particular, to reconstruct the social fabric. So let's see what I mean more concretely by these propositions, right? More concretely. When we struggled for wages for housework, we sort of took for granted that the struggle itself would change the work, right? And we were not too wrong about that, because when you enter into a process of struggle, you do change. You cannot really engage in a serious process of struggle without your subjectivity and without, discovering commonalities, without building a sense of the common good, the common interest. So, but in a way, we did not really think in ways. For example, we only later discovered that in the 20s and 30s, mostly, and even before, actually by the turn of the 20th century, there were feminists in the United States, who were interested in figuring out how the isolation of the home could be broken and more collective work of reproductive labor could be organized. And so there was some really interest. There's a beautiful book. If you haven't read it, you should take a look at it, by Dolores Hayden. She is a feminist urban planner, and she has written a book called The Grand Domestic Revolution. And the Grand Domestic Revolution looks at the efforts that a number of feminists, roughly in the period between 1880 and World War I, you know, engaged in to kind of rethink the relation between the home and the street, the home and the neighborhood, and then basically break the isolation in which women had been working. The limit is that most of them were white, middle-class women, right? And often they saw their liberation through organizing the labor of other women, right? This has always been really key issues in American politics, beginning with feminist politics. But their rethinking of reproductive work, you know, which in more recent years has really accelerated in other parts of the American continent. You know, for example, in various countries of Latin America, right, where people expelled from the rural area, you know, they are forced to urbanize, they go to the periphery of towns, and with nothing in their hand, they begin to put their work together, to come together, and rethink, you know, how do we organize our life? You know, how do we provide for food? How do we provide, how do we create streets? How do we collaborate to create housing? You know, many times bringing with themselves in the move from the rural areas to the town, bringing from themselves the influence of a communitarian relation, of an indigenous communitarian relation, which is still very strong in Latin America, right? And I've visited some of the villages, some of the favelas where this is taking place, and I've been so impressed and thinking about, oh my God, you know, the collective kitchen, the popular kitchen, you know, the urban farming, the merenderos where, you know, groups organized to provide some food to youth, and the popular assemblies. So this is, obviously, you know, you cannot think of exporting these experiences. But I see a trend growing in the United States as well, at the popular level. A trend that is born out of necessity. A trend that is born out of the realization that for an increasing number of people, neither the state nor capital are there. Neither the state or capital are the guarantee of survival. Quite the contrary. And so that they need, in a sense, to retake into our hands, right, some of the most important aspects of our life. And, you know, now this is appearing, is emerging in the form of limited projects. You know, across the country, for instance, time banking is beginning to become, you know, an accepted form of exchanging services, which I think is very interesting, right? We have seen the proliferation also of urban garden. You know, in many places now, people are organizing spaces that they define as commons of knowledge. Not like commons of knowledge in university where you have to pay for, but commons of knowledge in the sense of creating spaces where people can teach, learn, produce knowledge outside of a market relation, right? Outside of a monetary relation. I think the Occupy movement also was an expression of that need to break down the isolation, an isolation which is now continuously growing, intensified, both because communities have been torn apart, and they have been torn apart by gentrification, right, by police violence, by the dismantling of economic structures, right? And so the need to not confront, you know, the power that be, you know, in isolation alone. And I think it's promoting, you know, the need for people to come together. And I think the reproduction, the creation of more cooperative way of reorganizing our life, it's one of the steps, it's one of the strategy through which we can go beyond, right? Beyond struggling to improve our condition as labor power, as future workers within a given capitalist machine, and begin to work in a way that creates an alternative. And that alternative can only come, right, through, again, rebuilding a social fabric that today is continuously torn apart, and especially concentrating our struggle on protesting, denouncing, opposing the way in which, you know, we are being continuously divided. Thank you very much.